Good evening, everyone. I'm Vane Gypsy from Earthkeepers Connect in Goa, your host for this evening. The first day of the pre-summit webinars leading up to the second New Earth Summit in November, India's first integrative summit on solutions to our problems in health, food and farming, and environment. I extend thanks and gratitude from our summit convener, Daryl D'Souza, and all at Earthkeepers Goa to our esteemed panelists of today for taking out time to be with us and sharing their experience and wisdom so that we can all live healthier lives. Our topic for today is reversing chronic illnesses with natural therapy and lifestyle. So I will start by introducing our esteemed panelists to the audience. Varsha Nayak. Varsha Nayak is an ASIC at Goa College of Home Science, Kampal, Panaji, Goa. She had earlier served as Child Development Project Officer and Social Welfare Officer in the Department of Women and Child Development. Over the years, she has organized several need-based workshops and seminars for the growth of students, teachers, and allied community in Goa. She has a Master's in Food, Nutrition, and Dietetics from the University of Bombay and is UGC qualified for leadership. She has also done a Bachelor's of Electro Homeopathy Medicine from the Indian Board Alternative Medicine, distance mode. Her passion for research led her to register as a research scholar at Goa University in the Department of Biotechnology, undergraduate level, and over 5 years at the postgraduate level. She has presented papers at state, national, and international level seminars and conferences and has several publications to her credit. Now, I would like to speak about our next panelist, Mugdha Pradhan, a functional nutritionist, TEDx speaker, and founder of Thrive FNC. Mugdha has a master's degree in nutrition and has spent close to 2 decades in the area of health and wellness, using modern principles of functional medicine along with ancient wisdom about food, basing it on a sound foundation of spirituality. She recovered from a multitude of diseases, but she also reversed an autoimmune thyroid dysfunction, Hashimoto's. Moving to our next panelist, Dr. Neeru Goel. Neeru Goel is a holistic physiotherapist. She was born in Dominica, one of the Caribbean islands. When her folks who belong to Uttar Pradesh, she has lived, while her folks belong to Uttar Pradesh, she has lived across 6 states in India owing to studies and work. Before coming to Goa in 2013, she had worked for 8 years in the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. She has served in the CESA Football Academy, FC Bardez, Lempo Healthcare, Satsanga Retreat, etc. She has also been highly experimental on herself towards better health. She is a believer of living in sync with nature. Presently, she offers consultation on appointments in Goa. Daryl D'Souza went through 14 years of sickness that almost ended his life in 2004. His radical reversal from that state to a state of complete well-being within just 1 year of using integrated natural therapies is a story that has inspired thousands across the globe to lead healthier lives. His book, Become Healthy or Extinct, on curing chronic illnesses with integrated natural therapies, finds readership in close to 200 countries. Daryl does disease reversal workshops all across India. And he also served a 5-year term as the secretary of the World United Doctors and Healers Association. Daryl hosts platforms for doctors, healers, and therapists to work together and has curated and convened 4 mind, body, and spirit healing conferences. Daryl is also an organic farmer, an environmentalist, a TEDx speaker, founder of Earthkeepers Connect, the co-founder of Manipadma Foundation, convener of the New Earth Summit, and a speaker at the World Parliaments on Spirituality. So today we will have three rounds of questions for our panel that we plan to conclude in 1 hour so that we can keep the next hour for Q&A with our audience.
I would just like to repeat what he had said regarding today's format of the webinar. So we will have three rounds of questions for the panel that will conclude in 1 hour so that we may keep the next hour for Q&A with the audience who is waiting for us. So accordingly, we request each panelist to address the question in 5 minutes maximum. And there will be a bell that goes, so Warner will let us know, you know, when they are running over time. The first question to all the panelists is, what would you put down as the main causes of widespread chronic illness? The ones that people take regular medication for, like high BP, cholesterol, heart disease, and diabetes. So I request Mugdha Pradhan to please give her detail and insight into it.
Sure. So thanks. Thank you for that introduction, Werner, even though we dropped connection in between. And thanks for asking such a great question, because this is the work that I do, working on reversing chronic diseases. And in my opinion, the reason why people get really sick with all of these, right, the BP and diabetes and all of these, primary, right, root cause number one is eating the wrong kind of food. Like, there is no way around it. There just is no way around it. Like, we can't find anything bigger in terms of a contributor towards either health or disease than what's going into our body. And food is like the biggest contributor. So even if you have to look at like the medications that you spoke of, a high BP medicine, the pill that is given, it's in a micro dose, right? Like, it's milligrams or it's micrograms versus food, which most of us consume kgs of. So it is very short-sighted not to assume that the impact of such large volumes of whatever we're putting into our body is not going to create some kind of an outcome. So in my work, where we do a lot of blood tests and analysis to kind of figure out what's really causing the problem, most of the times people get sick because they're eating the wrong kind of food. And when I say wrong kind of food, they're eating food that is really far away from nature, which means they're eating a lot of processed and refined food, like refined vegetable oils, which is the primary trigger for insulin resistance, which causes diabetes. And then all these processed foods, right, these packet foods, anything that's made in a manufacturing plant is something that I just know can create a lot of health problems. So what people are eating without being aware of how that can impact their health is primary, like, root cause number one. The second reason why people get sick,
the line is dropping, of
environmental toxins. So, for example, somebody like me, I'm really careful about what I eat. But if I get exposed to a lot of toxins, like all these sanitizers and all these sprays that people are spraying all over for COVID-19, right? I know that I'll get sick because these chemicals are really bad. They can alter your genetics. They can alter your DNA. So environmental toxins are the second reason why I see people getting sick. How that impacts different organs, how that creates different health problems, of course, also depends on the genetic makeup of each person.
Right.
The third reason why I see people get sick is, you know, like, even if you take away the food aspect or even if you take away the toxin aspect, if somebody doesn't have good stress management techniques.
Absolutely. Like, okay.
Stress is always there. Stress is what triggers us to evolve and grow, right? But if you don't have the right techniques to perceive and respond to stress, that itself can make someone sick, because that can mess with your pituitary, adrenal, thyroid axis, and then that can create a lot of health problems. Now, what I'm seeing, and this is of a big concern because of with the 5G rollout that's happening, is the impact electromagnetic frequencies have on our health. You know, like, people don't realize is that even sleeping with your Wi-Fi on or sleeping with your phone right next to your head without it being in an airplane mode, or, you know, keeping your charger, like, you know, your phone plugged into the charger and sleeping with that next to your head, even that can create some level of disease, because in the end we are electromagnetic organisms, right? Even the mitochondria, or where energy is produced in our cell, that ATP production cycle, even that has an electron transport aspect to it. So the electromagnetic frequencies that are there around us, that we are mostly submerged in, that also is creating a lot of health problems for people, is what I'm seeing in my work. So the food that we eat, like eating the wrong kind of food, eating bad quality food, creating deficiencies because of that, toxins from the environment, stress and EMF is according to me what is at the root of this epidemic of chronic disease that we're seeing, besides which conventional medicine doesn't really have, like, nobody teaches them how to reverse this, right? Like, people, when they feel sick, they go to doctors first, and doctors honestly don't have enough of the tools to help their patients reverse these problems naturally without putting them on medication. So that's like reason number five why people are getting more and more dependent on medication. So I hope that answers your question, Werner.
Sure, sure. It does. Now then, you know, moving on, we can take the discussion to Neeru Goel, and, you know, see her take on this question.
It was very nice to hear from Mugdha, being a nutritionist, the way she's worked. And I think it has so closely related to major causes. All that she mentioned was very well appreciated. I could relate everything. I think I can do a bit of an add-on to what Mugdha just mentioned. So I feel that these diseases, blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, all these heart diseases, these are symptoms. These are not really real diseases, I feel. These are symptoms of a imbalanced general health. This is how I look at it. These are mere symptoms of imbalanced general health, and any kind of a specific health concern is to be addressed only after general health has been well addressed. And in the list of general health, I would say, yes, food is number one to consider in terms of what are we taking in, how much are we taking in, what timings we are taking in. That is about food for sure, the first concern. Then number two, I would say, how much balance do we have in our activity and rest time? So I believe when the body is living in an equilibrium in all respects, then there is no reason why systems should go in imbalance. So equilibrium, when equilibrium is disturbed, is when these diseases surface in the form of symptoms. So for example, diabetes is recognized clinically as with the presence of sugar in blood. Now, why sugar has come more in blood? Because it was not absorbed by the cells. So inefficient absorption by the cells is the problem. And why was it not absorbed by the cells? Maybe the environment of absorption was not good enough. For example, the enzyme of absorption of insulin. When proper sleep has been received, and when there is an appropriate pH value of the blood, which allows the kidneys and the endocrine system to function. So we need an alkaline pH level in the blood. We need enough sleep to the body in order to allow our hormonal system to function. Only then the cells are going to absorb from the blood. All the nutrition that we take through mouth finally reaches the bloodstream. From the bloodstream, it has to reach the cells only when we allow that environment for absorption. This is the crux. I mean, clinically, if I can explain, this is how I understand these problems. So probably if one has to look deeper, if one has to look deeper into it, then one has to question the digestive system, which means inefficient movement of food, inefficient absorption of food. One also has to look at the respiratory system, which means inefficient oxygen absorption in blood. If there is no oxygen medium, no food will be digested. So oxygen becomes that currency for digestion. So respiratory system patency is very much required. Then there is a concern on belief in health, self-belief in health and self-confidence, which is to do with self-esteem. So if there is self-confidence, the person will keep thinking towards health. In other words, meditate towards health rather than meditating on disease. So that kind of a mental attitude where I can say that tomorrow will be healthier than today. and the responsibility of my health is on me. I make my days healthier. So that kind of a self-esteem and self-responsibility towards health, rather than surrendering our health onto a so-called doctor who is going to cure us using medicines or some aggressive surgical procedures to get the cholesterol block out of an artery, thinking that this is the end of the disease. But what if that cholesterol block comes in another artery? So how many surgeries should a person go through? So self-confidence and self-responsibility, if this comes, it looks like quite a remedy and probably some hope we can see. So the essence of all this is that there seems to be a direct relationship between the hormonal system and the digestive system, which means that how I feel is it reflects on how much I absorb nutrition. When I'm happy, I'm healthy. That relationship between happiness and health, healthy feeling, and actually being healthy, chemically as well.
Sure. Yeah, I agree. I mean, it was very interesting, your whole concept of positivity. So, repeating the question now, going forward, about what would you put down as the main causes of widespread chronic illnesses, the ones that people take regular medications for, like high BP, cholesterol, heart disease, and diabetes. Now I'll take the question to Varsha.
I very well appreciate, with what Ms. Mugdha and Ms. Neeru has commented on. In fact, whatever I wanted to say has been partly conveyed through both the panelists. Rightly speaking, yes, there has been a tremendous shift, in our eating patterns or the dietary habits. Particularly when I talk about in Goa, we have seen a transition which has happened from a traditional diet, to the more Western diet, or I would say the impact, of travel and tourism also has caused a lot of change in the eating habits. Apart from that, the lifestyle in general, when we talk about, our physical activity has grossly reduced. Okay. In fact, now in this COVID pandemic situation, I've seen, meaning most of us, we have been sitting at home, but there are options, ample of options wherein we can actually wisely get involved in physical activity. Unfortunately, it's not happening. So two of the most important factors which are causing all this chronic illnesses is faulty eating habits and of course our sedentary activity. Now, today we are also talking about nutrigenomics, and there has been gut dysbiosis, which is also affecting most of our conditions, and that's one of the leading cause. So the medications, which I feel people believe more in medicines than the natural therapy, and that is what has led to I would say in India, which is referred to as the diabetic capital of world, or most of the chronic ailments which we see in India, it's purely because of the firm belief in medicines and not in the natural therapy. Metformin, medications like metformin, statins, even the ACE inhibitors, these have caused, in an attempt to manage with many conditions, this has inadvertently led to a lot of damage to our most important organs. And without even realizing, that it is causing, people are, I would say rapidly consuming them, and on a large scale, in fact. So it is a role to, intervene and talk to them about the ill effects or the side effects of this medication. So in fact, apart from, planning on diets and taking lifestyle habits, more education. In fact, we say that education is the most important thing which is required to take care of all these non-communicable or the chronic illnesses. Now, for that, I think a wise person would be, a person who has got right adequate knowledge on the various components. So more than, visiting the clinical practitioners, I think if a naturopathist along with a dietitian is, visited, I think our population at large can be managing well with all these chronic illnesses. Now, let me tell you about, the dietary aspect where we are failing, okay? We do not have adequate knowledge with regard to carbohydrates, okay? The type of carbohydrates that we are consuming is absolutely bad, okay? In fact, I get sometimes, my patients who say, diabetic especially, they say I do not have to, take sugar, but can I go in for jaggery because that's supposed to be in a healthier substitute? And this is all myth and the ignorance about the right kind of knowledge. Okay, so in fact, when it comes to even our uric acid metabolism, okay, the blame is always on the high protein foods, which is not so. I think it's carbohydrates again, which is responsible for be it obesity, be it cardiovascular diseases. Simple ailments like constipation, okay, which I've seen, large number of people are getting affected with, okay. So what we need to, I think, look at is understanding the whole essence of nutrition, understanding, the stress management, as Ms. Neeru has also commented on, because, eventually we require certain hormones. There is interplay of hormones which is happening, and that is actually taking a toll on the various health ailments, okay? So we need to, educate our population or our clients the best in the best possible way. So if you ask me to put, in clockwise fashion, I would put our diet first, exercise, right type of education, and last I would move on to the medications. That's the last resort, I would say. Yeah. So
That's it. Great. Thank you so much, Vashanayak. Now we will move to Daryl D'Souza and ask him for his take on this topic.
Yes, thank you, Werner, and wonderful to be in this panel. And I am in agreement with everything that the panelists have said and given their, different views. And so that I don't repeat, I'm going to give a different take altogether, which just popped into my head, but it has been what I have been telling people about. Okay, so this is for our audience too. This is the fact of life, okay? Let's not say it's good or bad right now. But for me, the biggest problem in people having sicknesses is because they have chosen to live in a concrete jungle, okay? So these concrete boxes. And at a summit a year back, I said the concrete jungles that we build and live in are the graveyards of humanity. Now, why is that so? I've got to say a bit about it. So when you get into a concrete box, okay, and you are with air conditioning, that is a different quality of air that you get in nature, then you are cut off from the ground. So you don't have earthing and you do not get enough sunlight. Now people know very well, all city-based people are deficient in vitamin D, okay? Then they are also deficient in a lot of gut microbiome that come from natural healthy food. But if a city-based person is going to be eating just packaged food that have got preservatives, they have to understand that such a preservative, whether it's, and those preservatives are chemicals that are causing, inflammation in the gut, and they are sources of free radicals that need antioxidants to be taken. So you do not eat fresh foods. You go on eating more packaged food products. Those chemicals, they go and kill all of your, microbiome, all your gut bacteria. Then how is your digestive system supposed to work? You see, how is that sugar and all of that supposed to be taken care of and balanced? So I have this chapter in my book called The Five Elements Therapy. And what I'm talking about is, I say in that the human beings also, this is from Ayurveda, we are made of the five elements, earth, water, fire, air, space. and sometimes people have difficulty understanding it. But I take it from the time a child is born and they are breastfed by the mother as the only source of nutrition. You know, the child is not walking bare feet to get the earth element. So, but that milk has got all the five elements. And you know that the prominent element is water. You also know it's got earth, because from that, the minerals of the calcium and magnesium, they get into your bones and they make the earth material of your body. Right? So I say that human beings were originally, they also need energetic forms of this nutrition. So when living in a concrete jungle, you are not getting the earth element, you're not getting the fire element, the air quality is so bad. Water. We are drinking water from pipes that are treated by chemicals, and there's no living bacteria to supplement our gut. Okay, so we're drinking damaged water. That's the reason so all of these five elements and the space element, living in cubicles, in stressful places, too close to each other, especially in office environments. So our space element is also invaded. And everybody knows, when you leave your home or your office and you go and stand on a mountaintop, you can actually feel your aura expand. You see, so in cities, we are living with all damaged natural five elements. And that's why we need to eat more nutrition. And the nutrition that comes there is not pure. So we are putting all of, a lot of lack of good things, abundance of toxic things. That's a recipe for sickness. Okay. So that's the reason I ran away from Bombay in 2010, because I could see all of this. I came to Goa, living in my ancestral place, started drinking well water, walking every day. I get grounding. I grow my own food. You see, I'm getting the sun and all of that. And that's the reason why people are, saying that I'm getting younger every year that they see me. And I just crossed 50 years, on 20th of September. So this is a big formula. And people say that it's difficult to do, but I was an engineer at the top of my career and supply chain consultant, CEO, up for CEO, after head of department. I left all of that and I came for a healthy, natural life. And there's more joy, so my stress is gone. There's more joy, there's more fun, there are more options in life. At least I've taken up a profession where I work for myself. So stress is low, okay, and good things in life are up. And I just want to give the message to our audience that yes, a lot of things are changing on the planet, and you need to see what is going to give you a natural, healthy life and move in that direction if you want good health.
Great. Thanks. So this was our first round. This was very interesting, especially where Daryl spoke about moving from the concrete jungle, how that was a big lifestyle change. Varsha Nayak spoke about understanding the whole essence of nutrition, interplay of hormones. Neeru Goel spoke a lot about meditating towards health, towards positivity. And Mugdha gave us the overall thought about how food, stress, pollutants, and of course, medicines affect us. So this was really great as a first round.
The second question was to all the panelists, what formula have you used, so far? What is it to help your clients reverse all of these illnesses? So if you could share that, please.
Okay. Yes, so my formula is pretty much in step order. So rule one is system cleanse. Very much like the way Daryl just expressed, I also believe in the five element balance in human body. So corresponding to each element, there is a physical filter that can be cleansed. So I will quickly name it. Element earth, being the most densest, has a filter called intestines, which needs to be cleansed. Element water has a physical filter called kidney, which can be cleansed. Element air, which is even rarer in its density. So air has a filter called lungs. Within respiratory system rather.
Neeru, you're on mute. Hello, Neeru, yes.
Element four, fire, which is even rarer in its density, has a filter called liver, which can be cleansed. Then the fifth element, which is almost abstract, but it has its existence in human body, which is space. We understand space with respect to feelings, emotions, thoughts, and the filter of space is mind. Now, to cleanse mind, it can take few days, few weeks, few months, depending on the receptive capacity of an individual. It can take any time. Space is the one that pretty much dominates the rest of the other four elements. So when the mind is in track, everything else falls in place. So these are the five systems that need to be cleansed using naturopathy techniques. No medicines required for this. One very good technique has been described in Daryl's book of Become Healthy or Extinct. There are so many other ways also of cleansing. For example, Panchkarma in Ayurveda is a cleansing technique. There are so many other ways within the natural realm that can be used for cleansing each system. Cleansing system means that we completely irrigate it, wash it, make it empty for once. Bring it back to baby body. Once the baby body is achieved, as raw as it was, as clean as it was when we were born, then we start working on it. So the first stage after cleansing would be rest. Deep rest. Very, very deep rest by pampering self. Deep rest can be achieved by just letting ourselves be in nature. Just to be in nature. With water, with all the natural sources of all these five elements, actually just to enjoy in all these natural sources of five elements, just that is rest. Then once the person has rested well is when we are now ready to stimulate, meaning start feeding this element little by little in very small doses to this individual through food, through environment, through the ambience. So each element has a special sense also associated with it. For example, earth has a special sense associated as smells, different smells. Then water has a different special sense associated to it, which is taste, all different flavors. So all these different aromas, different flavors, these are to be introduced to the individual little by little in very small doses. So that we don't need to have a spicy food to make it feel tasty. Even a simple bland food can taste tasty. If we have the appreciation for it, it will taste tasty. Okay, after this stimulation is well offered, then we need to do something in the name of maintenance. So maintenance would mean living in a state of equilibrium, the way I mentioned in the last question. Living in a state of equilibrium with respect to energy input, output, with respect to activity and rest, with respect to physical activity, mental activity, and then access to sunlight. Access to sunlight minimum 2 to 4 hours every day. Access to fresh air 24 hours. There is no time in the day when we can say we don't need fresh air. That means well-ventilated homes. And rhythmic movements in routine, for example, walking, pranayam, swinging movements. Being a physiotherapist, this is how I would begin movements, rhythmic movements. So this is pretty much that I feel is a formula that I propose, and with the confidence that body has the capacity to heal itself. So we just need to go with this belief that body does have the capacity to heal itself. Thanks.
That's a very Thank you. That's a really nice interpretation. And with that, I think we can move to Varsha and get her answer to this question.
Yes. Now, I would like to share with you all, you know, three case studies. Okay. I mean, that's the formula which I use to reverse certain conditions in some of my, well-known clients to me. Okay. So one of them had diabetes, and she was non-insulin dependent diabetic mellitus. Okay, so the formula which we adopted was, you know, just with right type of intervention, wherein we the dietary intervention, I would say, wherein the change was made, you know, in reducing the glycemic index of the food. So we realized, you know, that she was taking in more of the starchy foods and the simple carbs, okay, with a lot of processed foods. Okay, so that was changed. And, by increasing the fiber content of the diet, in addition to that, of course, the client was put on a regular brisk walking pattern for 45 minutes. In fact, I have published a paper to that effect, and it was an award-winning paper wherein, I would say therapeutic and lifestyle intervention helped, okay, a lot in reducing the blood glucose levels of this patient. It was a success story, okay. Secondly, even though we are talking about more of the chronic illnesses, but there are many more which has become now a major public health problems. Okay, so anemia is one such public health nutritional deficiency. Okay, so with I would say deworming, right, which many of us in whether we are from urban setup or from rural setup, okay, unfortunately this worm infestation has become one of the most common problems. Okay, so deworming, giving the best of the most absorbable form of iron. Okay, so again, it calls for a dietary intervention. Okay, with the vitamin C intake, I could bring up the hemoglobin levels to normal. Okay, normal in fact, 2 months time. Okay, and third case I would say is about gluten sensitive enteropathy. Okay, with irritable bowel syndrome. So again, the modifications were made absolutely in the diet, and in fact, this person was told to consume more of the fermentable foods, the fermented foods, and was put away from the gluten-rich foods, okay, particularly wheat. And, in Goa particularly, we are more of cereal eaters, wheat and rice. And the millets or the pseudo-millets which are there, they are being consumed, in very small amounts. So, in fact, millets, which it's a tradition of consuming them, for 5,000 years. It's in the last 3 decades we have seen that the consumption has reduced. So, the intervention was, replaced some of the millets replace some of the cereals with millets, the right type of millets, wherein the carbohydrate reduction was done. Okay, we tried to give, a good balance of omega-3 fatty acids to omega-6 fatty acids, because unfortunately the advertising companies, which take us for a very jolly ride, I would say, wherein they say you need to consume all the vegetable oils which are rich in PUFA without even giving us, the right type of ratio that we are supposed to have in the diet. Okay. In fact, I even practice personally, I include in my diet, and I've been telling many of them, stick to our local coconut oil, which is supposed to be very good in, medium chain triglycerides. And that is also, doing a lot of good. Okay. So the formula, in short, is therapeutic and lifestyle change, which has helped, okay, many of my patients in reversing some of their illnesses.
Great. That was very interesting. Thank you very much, Vashanai. And really good thoughts, especially around millet and coconut oil. And now we will move to Mugdha and take her answer to this question.
Thanks, Werner. And I absolutely resonate with the approaches both Varsha and Dr. Neeru have, because in the end, it is that holistic approach that really brings about healing. What we do at Thrive, that we practice functional nutrition, which I say is the opposite of dysfunctional nutrition. But what we do is we look at the mind-body-soul connection, right? All three. And we always begin with the question why. So like Dr. Varsha, Varsha was saying in her case study that this person presented with diabetes, and then she found the reasons why this person was diabetic. We always begin with the question why, right? So how do we answer the why? When it comes to the body, we look at blood tests. We do a complete analysis of, basic CBC, liver function, kidney function test. That tells us what's really going on. So when I spoke of the earlier root causes, right, or eating the wrong kind of food, deficiencies, toxins, stress, EMFs, we can actually find out which permutations and combinations of these different factors are really triggering disease in this particular body. Is it just a deficiency? Like she spoke of anemia. A lot of times people don't know that low hemoglobin levels or not enough iron can impact the thyroid gland. And then, the person gets diagnosed with a thyroid problem and they're given Eltroxin or one of these thyronorms. without understanding that the underlying root cause is they're deficient in the raw material that's required to make your thyroid hormones. So we look for these root causes when it comes to the body. We do blood tests. So we begin with the question, why? Why is this person presenting with this symptom? So how do we answer the why for the body? It is with blood tests. When it comes to the mind and the soul, this is personally my favorite part of working with anyone, because, you know, like even Neeru mentioned this, that often, like when she spoke of her approach with the elements and she spoke of the element of space and the mind, people don't know how much their conditioning and programming can in fact trigger more disease in their body. So when I start working on the mind, I actually look at, again, the why, right? So it can be a simple belief system that for my diabetes, I have to take metformin for life. So then I question that belief, like where did this belief form in the first place? And then we start looking at all the conditioning and the programming. And, you know, it's unfortunate how much mainstream media influences people's thought processes when it comes to any disease. Like look at COVID-19, right? Everyone is terrified of a virus that has a recovery rate of 99.997%. Why? Because TV is making it seem like it's this super dangerous thing that is worse than the Hiroshima-Nagasaki explosion that happened, right? So it's often media and wrong programming that actually conditions people's mind. So first we start with the body, because I believe the body is the foundation. Like, you know, if you take an analogy of a car and a driver, you could be the best of the best drivers. You could be a Formula One car racer. But if you're driving, if you're trying to drive an auto rickshaw on an expressway, the Bombay Pune expressway, there's no way you're going to accomplish the speed that maybe an Audi or a Mercedes would give you, right? So first, take care of that body, of that foundation where you're sitting as a driver. Then you start working on the driver's skills, which is the mind. And the last piece is the soul itself, right? Like I connect this with everyone's heart. And I think most of us have experienced some level of trauma as we were growing up because of the way we were parented, the way our authority figures dealt with us. Most of us have undergone trauma and it has resulted in heartbreak, right? Little tiny pieces of our heart are left all over the place. So I actually look at that aspect also, that how much of, like when we talk of emotional eaters, people who got sick because they're using food as, you know, their coping mechanism. Like every time something happens and they don't know how to deal with it, they'll go and dig into maybe a pastry or ice cream or something like that. So that is usually where soul healing comes in, because, you know, if you help this person deal with these kind of heartbreaks in a more cohesive, spiritual manner, then they will never rely on food for emotional fixes. So we start with blood tests because the body is the first place. Then we look at the mind and we look at where the conditioning and programming is coming from. So I work intensely on that aspect. And the third is we bring in the aspect of spirituality and connection to source itself, right? Because all of us are expressions of the divine infinite light. And usually it's the trauma that makes us forget this. So my job is to just remind people that, hey, like, you are the universe and it's there. And, you know, maybe this meditation will help you remember that. Or maybe this particular substance will help you remember that. But that's the job. So it's the body, the mind, and the soul. And when all three are healed, the person is truly healed. And you know, that person would never ever need somebody else to guide them with their health. They'll just be independent. They'll know what to do to take care of themselves. So that's my approach. But it always begins with the why. So the first question is why. Like I even ask people, why do you want my why do you want to pay me? So it begins with that, right? Like, don't pay me until you answer that why.
All right. We'll have to move. So that was great because what's coming through is holistic healing, and that's great. And we will move to our summit convener, Daryl D'Souza, and hear his answer to the question.
Yes, thank you, Werner. And I'll just continue from where I left off by giving people a scare about, you know, most of the population in this world are living in concrete boxes. So that moving to the village and all may seem very, you know, challenging for most people, and they say that's not really a formula. But I look at entire ecosystems within societies, within country, and I look at planetary ecology also. Okay, and there is an imbalanced model that has been implemented to a majority, because if you settle for, you know, this concrete jungle, like I said, in those concrete boxes, there is, you are getting packaged food products. Now, if a person educates themselves to not have these packaged, you know, artificial dead food that brings a lot of toxins in your body and does a slow kill on you, once they understand they don't have to do that, they try to get organic, okay? And organic is never made in that city. It's made somewhere else. So then you got transportation time, okay? There is a carbon footprint to it. And then there is, you know, there are some of my patients in Delhi said, you know, I want fresh food. You know, can you get it from, you know, the from the village to this place in refrigerated vans? Then, yeah, instead of tomatoes costing $40, they could be $240 a kilo. Okay. So this is what, see, when you agree to that concrete jungle and you try to be healthy, I'm saying it's not possible. So there's a carbon footprint, there's a high cost of food. Then who's going to get you your sunlight, you see? Who's going to get you water? There is no natural water in the city. So does that mean that every city, every person is going to be drinking mineral water? Is that manufactured in a factory? I'm talking mineral water, real groundwater and well water, you know, that is real water. So there are so many challenges when you try to live in the city. And only once people see it as a systemic problem, then they will look for a systemic solution. Okay, so that's one part of it. Then the second thing is that, you know, in my research, I've seen that people who live long, okay, that is centenarians, research was done on them and they could only find them in the villages. And when they looked at, you know, what's your routine, especially with regard to fitness, they don't do any workouts or exercises. They're just moving around all day. So it's just flexibility, okay, and suppleness that gets them to, you know, 102, 103, 104 years of age. So there is no such thing as, you know, and I'm going to make a comparative because people don't, they only know the reality that they live in. Now, here's a comparative. The people living in the Amazon forest or, you know, the rainforest, we have some of the shamans coming here to, you know, Goa to teach us plant medicine and they go all across the world. So there are many tribes, okay, in different countries. They live on the land. They're much healthier than us. They've never had high BP, cholesterol, diabetes. I mean, that 200 illnesses that we have, okay? Maybe they have a little lack of food because things are scarce, okay? But they do not suffer from any of our chronic illnesses. They get all the five elements over there in their purity. So we have to look at, and I look at it as the foundational structured systems of lives are so permanent and forever. We are people come here in the last, you know, 100, 200, 300 years trying to make our own theories and formulate our own diets without being, you know, without seeing nature having any relationship to what I call living sciences. Most of our sciences are made in laboratories. I call them, you know, dead sciences or formulated sciences in the minds of, you know, men. But, you know, you never have to tell a forest person what is food. You never have to lecture him on nutrition. Neither do you have to lecture him on health. Okay. And there's no stress at all because they're having a ball of the time, you know, in their natural surroundings. So I have this chapter in my book that's called Natural Health Therapy. And the first step in it says, stop abusing the body. That means stop doing the wrong things to the body. So for, you know, people, it would be in terms of food, stop having artificial man-made food. Try to go closer to what is natural and available in nature for human beings. Okay, so get your fresh fruits, vegetables, nuts, beans, peas, you know, all from farmers and organic markets. Then the second part is that start doing the right things. So, of course, getting the right minerals and vitamins if you have been mineral or nutrient deficient. Also, yeah, doing the right things means, you know, resolving your relationship issues. If you have a lot of stress happening just because of work, you need to revisit that, you know. Now, why do I have an option in life and do I need to be so stressed in this kind of job that I've taken up? Then the third part is, you know, the third step is detox your body or get all the junk out. Now, why is that the third step? Okay, because it can only happen once you've understood what is the junk you should not put in your body. Because those who have not understood step one, you know, they do cleanses for the rest of their life because they're putting in junk always. So they got to clean it out all the time. So I said, step one is stop putting junk in your body. Stop following unnatural practices. Stop having too much of Wi-Fi around the place. right? And even you could say even the stress, stop having stress relationships with people or in stressful environments. The second step would be, you know, do the good things good for your body. So fresh food, good sunlight, good water, good relationships. Human life is, you know, there's a furnace inside, and that furnace, that's what I call your living fuel. Your living fuel depends on your intentions and what you want to do in life. You know, all of your life, if you're going to be working for somebody else because of what they want, you're not going to be happy about doing that work, but some satisfaction will come because you're getting money. So after these two steps, the third step, which is detox your life, this is what Neeru Goel spoke about. And so once you've stopped putting junk in your body, then you've got to clean your liver, your digestive system, your kidneys. So there are herbal natural cleanses that are there in my book also, and many other books, you know, it's a part of naturopathy. So people should do that. And the last is use healing systems to heal yourself. For example, I teach acupressure, okay, and a bit of herbalism also for healing. So those are systems that just help the body accelerate. These things are not going to prevent you from doing the wrong things, right? So you first have to stop doing the wrong things and, you know, stop that violence against your body. And after you've done that, then things like acupressure, moderate exercise, I say more of flexibility, pranayama, meditation, right? That's my formula for people. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, everyone. So, I mean, this was really interesting. Moving on, I think now we can speak to our viewers in a sense and tell our viewers how they can access our work and services. So this is where we get to speak about ourselves. So we can start with Varsha Naik.
I think the best would be, my phone number, which in the past also I have shared. And they can, of course, very well contact. And of course, with prior appointments. However, you know, I've got also certain constraints. So I have been, assigning my patients or clients. Now we are supposed to use the term clients and not patients. Okay, so I've given them to certain practicing dietitians who have been doing wonderful job in their field. So yes, I'm there along with them as well. Apart from that, you know, I'm sorry, I would just like to add on, you know, we spoke about cleansing, okay? And right. I missed on that point. I would like to share about my father-in-law. You know, he had this psychological feeling that, you know, he has to take something which will help him to get relief from, you know, his bowel habits, okay? The irregular bowel habits that he had. You know, one day I just recollected my grandmother had told me about this senna leaves. In fact, they're freely available sodmukhi leaves, which are called as, and it is doing such a wonderful job when it comes to, you know, cleansing your gastrointestinal tract. So I would want to ring each one of you who are used to taking this isabgol husk, you know, or the over-the-counter, high fiber, which are just expensive, but we get something which is in a reasonable amount, and I think that can do a very good thing. Secondly, about vitamin D, I would like to add on, okay, Dr. Neeru has mentioned about, you know, 3 to 4 hours exposure, you know, but even a daily 15 minutes to half an hour exposure between the window of 10 to 3 p.m., okay, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m., okay, is going to do a wonderful job of giving us the best source of vitamin D, okay. So coming back to services with me, yes, over the phone. And my phone number is 942-280-6934. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you. So now we'll move on to Mugda and take her answer to this.
So I can be reached in multiple ways. One is people could go check the website, which is thrivefnc.com. If someone's looking for my number, you could get in touch with is 7796692504. I'm repeating that, it's 7796692504. And if someone wants to send me an email, I can be reached at mugdha@thrivefnc.com. So I'll just type it, I think, here in the chat as well for everyone to access that. The way we work is we have, so Thrive has a team of really amazing functional nutritionists. All of them are masters in nutrition. All of them have clinical experience. And we actually work with people on a three-month journey, and it's a very interesting the way we do it. We offer real-time response, so we're there with them, right there to talk to them when they need it. But if someone wants to learn more about the entire work, like going to the root causes, what blood tests do we look at, how do we fix those root causes, then they could either send me a mail at mugdha@thrivefnc.com, or they could reach the number that I mentioned earlier. I'll just type it in the message as well so that everyone receives it. That's how they can reach out to me. And the website, and I'm very active on Facebook. I think Daryl knows that. I keep posting my opinions there. So I'm Mugdha Pradhan on Facebook. I'm Mugdha Pradhan on Instagram. I'm quite active on social media. So if anyone wants to connect with me just like that, not to get a consultation, but just to be connected, you can reach out to me there as well.
All right. That's great. And now we'll move to Neeru Goyal. Yes, your answer, please.
So here I am. Right. And I have also typed my number in the chat box.
All right. Thank you so much.
Digital.
More questions are coming in for that from our attendees, and we hear you. So, yes, I think from here we'll move to Daryl.
Yes, thank you, Varna. So the way to get in touch with me is actually I stopped taking personal consultations now since almost a year, only because I've been doing that since 2005. Now I work a lot in organic farming, you know, doing creating platforms, conferences, and now I'm also into environment and, you know, local village economy. So I have a lot of projects going on. So the access that people can have, of course, they can access all of my work anytime. The first place to go is to my website on health, my first website, which is becomehealthyorextinct.com. And there I advise people to, you know, download my book first and go through it, read it, get all of the basic, you know, concepts and understandings correct, and work on themselves. People have, you know, reverse diabetes just by reading my book and doing it themselves. And when I had my next, you know, public kind of workshop here, that was the first time it happened in 2012 in Goa. When I did a public workshop, I had somebody came and gave a testimony of how they reverse diabetes, reading and following what was in my book, how they did it within 1.5 months. So there's a lot of, so that's the first point of interaction for people who want to, you know, get some advice from me. Please download my book. It's a free download. Go through it. Help yourself to whatever degree you can. And then, of course, for the second level, I used to do 2 workshops a month, a full day intensive workshops in different metro cities in India. And that came to a halt right in the middle of, you know, I had scheduled for March, April and May. And that's when the lockdown happened. So I could just do my workshop in Bangalore. And then I couldn't do in Bombay and Delhi. And that's when I opened up an online workshop. So that's a 12-hour, again, a 12-hour. I said something wrong. My day workshops in the different cities is like a 9-hour intensive. So from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. But now that's become an online workshop for 12 hours, which people can do over 2-3 days. Okay. And if they just go to my health website again, Become Healthier Extinct. And in the second tab of, you know, therapy, you can see the details of the workshop there. A lot of testimonies from across the country who have attended it. So just follow the instructions there, get enrolled and, you know, do the workshop. I'm teaching acupressure in that. And for the longest time, I was not doing, online workshops, thinking that I could not teach people acupressure online. But it happened very wonderfully and beautifully with a lot of videos and a lot of detailed instructions. So that's how people can access my work. And once somebody has done my workshop and they know all of those things, this is how I operate now. Then I know they thoroughly understand the integrated natural system that I teach, which is a combination of diet and nutrition, acupressure for diagnosing and healing weak organs, herbs for healing, then the natural detox, a cleanse therapy, and then the five elements therapy also, what I spoke about, and a few other natural processes. So yes, that's how people can access what I offer.
All right, that's great. I think a lot of people have been asking and they've got the answers in chat. Just one question which has come in now from the chat is, could you please tell us about the book on diabetes from Narinder Garg? I believe this goes to Daryl on the book on diabetes.
Okay, so I did not mention about that book. In fact, I've not heard about it. I don't know if any of the other panelists mentioned it, so they could answer it, or if they know about that book, please comment.
Can I? May?
Yes, yes.
Is this the book Diabetes A to Z by Dr. K.D. Garg that our attendees asking about?
Possible, yeah. We'll just see if
because I am aware of this book, and in fact, it's a very nice book, okay? Diabetes A to Z by Dr. K.D. Garg, which says control your life, and the focus is entirely on the biochemical parameters of diabetes mellitus, you know, the assessment and the dietary and lifestyle intervention that has been mentioned about that. Yeah, so that
all right. Is available.
So I would also like to mention, as a reply to that, of course, like I said, I don't know the work of Dr. Narinder Garg, but to our audience today, and especially to the person who asked the question, tomorrow is the day where we are, taking up reversing diabetes. And there I can tell you the foremost, people in the front who are the leading people who in India, at least, who are reversing diabetes are on the panel tomorrow. Dr. Pramod Tripathi, Dr. Nandita Shah, Dr. Rupa Shah, Dr. Alok Chopra, who stays in Delhi, and Dr. Pawan Vandavan. So come online tomorrow and you will get some amazing insights into reversing diabetes.
Right, there was a question about
Same Zoom ID and same time, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m.
All right. So the next question is by Adil Rashid. What are the long-term side effects of RO water? What purifying system should be used at homes instead of RO? Anybody who would like to take it?
Personally, I would advise, and the little bit of microbiology knowledge that I have, I would advise everyone to go in for thorough boiling of water. Okay, wherein we say usually. Even after it starts to give those boils, okay, that you should keep water for another 10 to 15 minutes. And that's going to take care of all the microorganisms. Now, of course, we are talking about the mineral water and, the RO water. Now, you are the best person to decide on what exactly you want from them. Now, it's from nutrients point of view, I think it's our food that can take care of. Now, for water, which we require for hydration purpose and to take care of that, 2 to 3 liters of daily water intake, what we require, I think the best would be stocking water overnight, let it settle down. The next day you take the top water and then boil it for at least 20 to 30 minutes. That in fact has proven, many studies has proven that it can, take it away from, keep it free from the microbes that we are not interested in.
Yeah? Great. That's a great answer.
I agree with Varsha boiling water, because anyway, most of the city-based people are getting water through pipelines, and you see chlorine is put in it. So if the question is, are we killing, the good bacteria in the water, you have to understand that it's already, most of it is already dead, the good bacteria. And if you get some infectious bacteria, that's what they're trying to kill with chlorine. So now the boiling the water is also what I've done. I've been through this journey for, you know, right from the time I got sick, like from the year 2000. I mean, I was sick right from 1991. But this aspect of what I've been working on since 2000, when we bought our first, you know, Kent RO water filter in Mumbai, when I used to live over there. And I could see that once the candle was, you know, about 9 months old, then even though servicing was done, if servicing was done regularly every 3 to 4 or 5 months, then it would maintain its, you know, quality. But even after 2 years of the machine, you know, the quality, water quality would get bad. If anybody in the house had a weak stomach and they would drink that water for 3-4 days, they would fall sick. So from that time I said, you know, let's just boil all the water. It's at least it's lake water that has got the minerals and it's got some chlorine. So the boiling actually, and after you boil it, keep it open, because that chlorine vapor takes about 3 to 5 minutes to get out of the water. So by that you have, you know, you have sterilized water, but it does contain the minerals from your, you know, from the lake or wherever it is sourced from, or dam. And it's got the chlorine out. And so that is the simplest water. Then there, of course, I've been researching Kangen water and Nicken water also since that time, since 2005, I think. It's been 10 years. Since 2010. It's been 10 years and they are wonderful, amazing machines, but they cost like, you know, 1,26,000. And what they do is what I'm getting here in Goa. Okay. When you go through the brooks and streams, the water breaks, it gets its electrical charge, it becomes micronized, it's got the, bacteria, even the Kent, the Kangen water is not going to give you good, you know, bacteria that are going to give you vitamin B12 and all of that. So that's the reason. So I don't need to do all of that because I've come here, but there's so much of contamination happening of the groundwater here that our own well water now we're not able to drink since last 3-4 years over here. So on the point of RO water, it's completely, you know, so much of the minerals are taken out from it. So first point I made that if an RO water filter is about 3 to 4 years old, it is not killing all the germs. Okay. Secondly, the water itself has gone very low in minerals. And if somebody's sick and all, I would say that you take that water, you boil that water, put some electrolyte in it, you know, and get some electrolytes. Or people do all of this. They cut the, you know, saline, or you create a mineral water yourself. Tiny pinch of rock salt, little saline, okay, little even what you can say natural sugar, or little gourd also. Some people, instead of that, they'll put honey. So you get some nutrients in that water. That's much better.
Great. All right. From this question, we move to another question, which is coming on from Snigdha Joshi, is how to reverse Hashimoto disease. So I leave this open, although I believe Mugdha has...
Yeah, so I would really like to answer this because I had Hashimoto's. I actually did have antibodies to the thyroid when I was really sick. This was 2016. Now the thing there, what I and this is the entire functional medicine, functional nutrition approach, right? Like any autoimmune condition. So the thing is, no disease happens just like that. Your body doesn't create disease. Even an autoimmune condition, your body is not mad to attack itself. It's trying to get to something else, where the thyroid tissue actually becomes a bystander. So even with Hashimoto's, what happens is often you could either have heavy metals that are triggering that kind of a reaction in your thyroid gland, like mercury itself could be a problem. You could have pathogens which are creating this issue, right? So Epstein-Barr virus, H. pylori, all of these pathogens can actually cause your body to trigger, you know, get triggered into creating autoimmune antibodies against the thyroid. A lot of people who are sensitive to dairy, actually, because dairy and gluten share this thing called as molecular mimicry, where their molecules look identical to the thyroid tissue. And your body, in an attempt to kind of deal with that inflammation coming from these gluten dairy molecules, ends up attacking the thyroid tissue. So a lot of times the autoimmune antibodies that your body is creating towards thyroid, which is what Hashimoto's is, these antibodies are created for some other cause in the body. And like a thyroid poor thing gets attacked. That's what was happening in my case. I had an overload of mercury, which came from this silver amalgam filling wala tooth that I had. I am still terribly sensitive to dairy and both gluten, and that was also making my Hashimoto's worse. Besides which, stress can make it worse. So the goal with Hashimoto's is first find out what are the level of antibodies you have, then start finding out what in your body, what in your environment, what in your diet is really triggering those antibodies. Eliminate that, and your body, see, your body loves to heal, okay? Every human body has been designed that it's a self-healing machine. It's the most incredible machine on this planet. I call it machine, but I can't find any other word in the English language to describe it. It is a self-healing, self-regenerating. Like Daryl looks like he's 25 when he's 50, right? It's like that. It can regenerate itself. I looked much worse when I was sick in 2016 than I do now. So it wants to heal. It really wants to heal. It wants to live for as long as possible. Because like I said, you are the universe existing in a human form, right? So the body wants to serve that universe for as long as possible. So the minute you take away things that are harming it, immediately it will start healing and, you know, it will start recovering. So with Hashimoto's, the simplest thing to do is find out what is triggering your Hashimoto's, remove all of those things, give your body what it needs for healing, whether it's nutrition like vitamin D, sun exposure, being in nature, you know, using nature to kind of eliminate the stress. And like Daryl spoke of being on a mountaintop and your aura just expanding. It really happens, right? When you're in nature, when you're in the middle of a garden, you just feel different. You feel so expanded as a consciousness. But doing all of that, making sure you're giving your body the right nutrition, making sure you're giving your body all the raw material it needs to repair itself, fix itself. Sometimes Hashimoto's can be triggered by what we call as a leaky gut, where your gut is so damaged that food is now escaping from your gut. Like, you know, I'll get technical and I'll run out of time. But your small intestine has this layer called the villi, which are there to absorb food. Now, often when you're eating gluten or when you're eating food that's inflammatory, including stuff like chips and Maggi, this villi start getting flattened. And at some point of time, because these villi are so damaged now, the small intestinal wall lining can start breaking open. And then undigested food particles start escaping into your bloodstream. That itself starts creating an inflammatory reaction in your body. So always, 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 no matter what the disease or what the diagnosis or what the label is, whether it's diabetes or whether it's atherosclerosis or whether it's Hashimoto's or whether it's fibromyalgia, we work with fibromyalgia patients also, right? No matter what the label is, the question is, what is really creating this? Find that out, eliminate those causes, give your body what it needs to heal, and your body will heal. So that's my answer. That's how I reversed my Hashimoto's too. And it doesn't take time. That's the most beautiful part of it. It's really quick.
Right. That's great. Varsha, you wanted to say something?
Mugdha has kind of answered that, okay, of eliminating the triggers, which plays a very important role. In fact, we had one patient, in fact, he was, you know, an adolescent boy, and, you know, just eliminating, he was to be fond of peanuts, okay, so, I mean, later on we realized, was it, the aflatoxins, which was resulting into, high amount of, you know, the other nutrients which are there that was causing the problem. So we had to, you know, eliminate peanuts from his diet, and, you know, we saw a very significant improvement, you know, in this patient. Okay. So it's very important to know the trigger and the component which is causing this, and do away from your diet. Yeah.
Great, great. Thanks.
So I would also like to mention for thyroid, work from, you know, people has also been showing, like Mugdha mentioned, you know, gluten. So I have seen through a lot of research that rice and wheat are not even, you know, the most natural grains for human beings. And people who are giving up these grains and moving on over to millets, they are having, you know, better results for thyroid. Secondly, in my book, I just remember, you know, on page 80, it says when you're trying to heal thyroid, you can try and avoid for some time cruciferous vegetables, okay, which irritate the throat, especially in their raw form, like, the salad leaves, you know, ice lettuce and all of that. And even raw, if you're trying to eat raw cabbage or broccoli, so that will make the thyroid more sensitive. So it's better to not have them raw, but have them, you know, well cooked. That would help a thyroid patient. And the second thing, like I said, is moving over to having more millets in your diet. I typically advise people to have a millet breakfast. Of course, the first breakfast I always say should be fruits. And then if people feel hungry, depending on the kind of work they do, if it's more physical, you'll feel hungry. Maybe you can have some millets. Then the only time I advise grain is like for lunch. And that also, I call it semi-polished rice. I never call it brown rice because you get varieties of brown, you know, rice that are brown, even though they're 100% polished. So I just say maximum, you know, semi-polished rice for lunch and evening tea and, you know, even dinner should be millets. And with that kind of diet, a lot of people are, you know, reversing illnesses and getting healthier. And by weight, millets will have more than, you know, more fiber, minerals and vitamins as compared to rice and wheat. Whereas rice and wheat are more of complex carbs. They're going to give you more acidity and of course, put on, you're going to put on a lot of weight with them being converted. You know, there's such so much of glucose that is being created.
Right, right. So that's a very important question. Now moving to the next one from Maheshwara Alamuru is how to reverse Crohn's and colitis. I hope I pronounce everything. If anybody would like to take this question.
Yeah, I can answer that as well because we actually work with somebody who had ulcerative colitis. I spoke about her even in my TED talk. She was on immunosuppressants for 13 years. And every time she would have a flare-up, she would be completely bedridden. And it's so funny, right? Like, all she needed was like a few simple things and her gut started healing. So, her gut was severely damaged. What I spoke about, like her small intestinal lining, it was completely eroded, right? So, she really was unable to digest a lot of food. She would have a flare-up. Her colon would get inflamed so often. In her case, and again, see, It's very hard to give a generic answer for me because my entire work relies on looking at blood tests and finding root causes. But in her case, what really worked is we eliminated both these gluten and dairy, both known irritants to the gut. What we also did is we brought in a lot of gut healing nutrients. There's an amino acid called glutamine, which you get just as amino acid. So glutamine really is good at repairing the gut. If you're somebody who eats animal protein and animal meat, adding bone broth will bring about a similar healing. So bone broth is really good for healing your gut. If you're not somebody who's eating animal products, then that's not an option. And glutamine itself can work. And then there are other herbs. There's something called a slippery elm. There's something called as marshmallow root. All of these herbs are very good at helping the gut itself repair itself. And then, like Daryl said, right, in her case also, we reduced her grain intake quite a bit because we didn't want anything that would trigger irritation around the gut. So fruits were there, but again, not in too many large quantities because then the volume of fruit itself, initially at least, at the initial phase, it just became like, because even a gut microbiome was messed up, all the bacteria were wrong, everything was wrong. So even eating fruit would trigger a lot of gas and fermentation in the gut because of the fruit sugars that were there. In her case, otherwise I'm absolutely in love with fruits. So what we did a lot of healing of the gut with glutamine and marshmallow root, slippery elm. We brought in also aloe vera that she would have aloe water in the night. So you peel off the aloe's green skin, you just take the gel. So don't buy these, who's that guy, Baba Ramdev's aloe juice and all that. But, you know, just the aloe vera leaf, remove the green peel, take the inside gel and in a mixer with water, just blend it. So she would have that every night before sleeping. So that would also kind of soothe her gut overnight as she slept. And again, like because her gut was so bad, she was deficient in a lot of nutrients. Like she couldn't even absorb a lot of nutrients. Right? So she had anemia. She had so many nutritional deficiencies. So we brought in supplements specifically to fix those nutritional deficiencies. And then we also took care of the gut microbiome with good quality probiotics. So it was a journey. It didn't change overnight. But at the end of the first, like after 1.5-2 months, she had completely stopped taking all her immunosuppressants. And she told her doctor, okay, I'm stopping this. And her doctor was like, don't come to me if you get a flare-up. I don't know how that is even a compassionate answer to give to somebody who's suffering for so long. But she's been off all medication. Now it's been 2.5 years since we started working with her. But that is also, you need to heal your gut. you first take out everything that will irritate the gut, right? So gluten, dairy, these hard to digest grains, even big legumes like chole, rajma, all of these are very hard for the gut to digest. And then bring in softer food, right? Like softer and easy to absorb food, and then look at the deficiencies, fix those, and like focus primarily on healing your gut from inside. Like that tissue needs to be healed. That entire garden that we call the gut microbiome, that garden needs to be gardened properly, and all the weeds have to be removed out. So that's what we did in her case. That's what we do even with people who come to us with IBS, IBD, and those kind of health concerns.
All right, all right. So
I would just like to also touch upon what Mugdha said about taking out milk from the diet. Because I came from a background of, 10 years of amoebic colitis, okay? And I was still under the treatment of allopathic doctors at that time. That's why, who were trying to kind of give me more antibiotics, and that kills more of your gut bacteria. And then your guts are not functioning anyway. And I used to get, loose motions and blood in my stools, and my stools wouldn't form, okay? So antibiotics were not really the answer. But through my own trials, this is what I understood. Because I could feel the heat in my gut. So the first three things for anybody who's got amoebic colitis or Crohn's disease or a weak intestine was what I mentioned earlier. The first thing I realized was that, water filter thing. Started boiling my water. Okay. So no bad bacteria or anything would come inside. So that was the first. Second thing is what a homeopathic who was trying to heal me. He said, Dr. Hector Mevawala, Parsi in Mumbai. He said, green chili is your worst enemy. So so then I got that. I couldn't make out. Yeah, if I eat green chilies and red chilies, my intestine would be inflamed. The highly alkaline. People don't understand that highly alkaline can burn and highly acidic can also burn. It's not that highly alkaline will give you cooling and all of that. Put, that 11.5 or 12 pH water on your skin and you'll see it burn in 5 minutes. Okay. So that is the second thing. Stop having these harsh spices that cause inflammation. So this is still in the domain of don't do this. Okay. What are the good things that you should do? Mugdha has already mentioned something. So don't have a water that's not boiled. Okay. If you have an excellent machine, then okay, you can have that water and it's well maintained. So have boiled water. Second thing, don't have too much of green chili, red chili, black pepper in your food. Don't cause inflammation to your intestines. And the third was milk. Okay. And I was at this stage where I used to have this half glass of milk and I used to, get loosies the next morning and even fissures and piles. I went all the way to third degree piles and had to be operated. But in my own experiment, I saw if that half glass milk, I would dilute it with 50% water. Then my next day's stools would not be so bad and my fissure or something would heal in 3-4 days. And like a big scientific, I was an engineer at that time, I used to wonder, how can this that a newborn baby has, the most basic food, how come it's giving me blood in my stool? Okay. And I kept on having that half glass for about a year. And then I was not having much healing. Then I stopped the milk completely. Okay. And then within 1 week, things are working much better for me. So I've seen this practically. So that's what I say. The science of what is so wrong with milk and why is it not digestible? Why does it cause acidity? And also, lactose intolerance is not a disease. It is a normal state of the human body. In fact, no mammal has milk after the age of 4 years. And a transition happens into the entire digestive system. So it's like, now you take a modern computer and you try to put a floppy inside. There's no opening for a floppy, but somebody will say, damn it, I'll crush this floppy and, put it in one air vent of the computer. Of course, our computer is going to crash. Okay, so this is what people are doing with some foods. And I say, milk products for adults, it defies natural science. There's no living science on this planet that says that, adult mammals should have milk products.
All right. Thank you, Dad. Moving to the Q&A, Shripad Barne has asked, what is the best food pattern for healthy life? 3 times a day or every 2 hours small portions? A lot of confusion on this. Please clarify.
Mukta, would you like to? since you're a practicing, a nutritionist.
Yeah, sure. So, see this, what I've learned of late, even I, until 1.5 years ago, I would tell people eat every 2 hours and eat small frequently, okay, keep your blood sugar levels constant and all of that. But what I've learned now is that every time you eat, you're triggering insulin release, because insulin needs to go and help your cells absorb glucose, right? So there's like a phase one insulin response, which happens as soon as you put food in your mouth. And there's a phase two response, which happens after the food is digested and glucose comes into your bloodstream. And it turns out that eating very often and continuously through the day is not so great for your insulin sensitivity. Actually, it is bad. And again, if you look at the pattern like our ancestors had, right? They didn't really have an abundance key. They didn't have a kitchen that was stocked up all the time. I'm just feeling like chewing on something because I'm bored and I'm going to go eat something. They would typically mostly forage and hunt and gather. So their food intake would be at longer intervals. Like they'd spend more time looking for food than actually eating food. And we've actually started implementing that even at Thrive. We are making sure people are not eating through the day. And we're seeing so much improvement in their blood sugar management. So there's really no need to eat every 2 hours. I know there are popular nutritionists who say eat every 2 hours. Again, see, if somebody has extreme glucose dips, like they have hypoglycemic episodes because they've not been able to control their diabetes, at that time, it needs a different approach. But if you're metabolically healthy, if you don't have any major illness in the body, like I personally eat only two meals. I eat breakfast and then I have lunch and then that's it. I don't even need more food than that. And my portion size is also very small. Most of our clients, patients, whatever you want to call them, eat like three good nourishing meals. Some of them, if their food is so nutrient dense, like in the first two meals, they really are not hungry for dinner. And because we do blood work before and after, right? So we know also if they're becoming deficient, because it's not about starvation. It's really about giving your body all the nutrients it needs when it needs it. And then like you don't need to eat through the day. Again, a lot of people have trouble, differentiating between their hungers. So nutritional hunger is actually the only hunger you should feed with food, which is a need for nutrients. People have anger hunger when they become angry or something and they want to go eat. People have emotional hunger, which is like what I spoke of, right? They eat because they don't know how to deal with their emotions. So they use food to numb those emotions. Sometimes people mistake thirst with hunger. So sometimes thirst becomes disguised as hunger because, again, if you look at how our ancestors ate, they didn't really have access to water all the time either. Sometimes a lot of their water came from food, like fruits and vegetables, right? That would give water also. So sometimes your body sends you a signal for hunger when it's actually feeling thirsty. So learning to differentiate what hunger you're actually experiencing becomes really important. But I personally don't go with this philosophy anymore of eat every 2 hours. I see that everything metabolically improves much more if you eat lesser food. Like less is good, like lesser food is good. We are a generation of over fed and undernourished human beings, I think.
I would also, like to share some insights on this. Going back, starting from the least amount of meals. Okay, first I'll talk about natural science and what human beings have come from if you live in nature and many other species. So if you look at nature, you can see, in the morning, there is no breakfast being served, to whether it's birds or this or that. You see, there's no breakfast being served. So they get up in the morning and they are hungry. So they're going to spend 2-3 hours, looking out for food. And then they reach at 12 o'clock. Now this I'm telling you, eating at when the sun is up and then when the sun is down. Okay. This was done by ancient yogis. Now, if you read the sciences from the Jain Munis, okay, I listened to a lecture where they are giving such detailed explanations of when the food is happening, what's happening in the digestive system, and how long does it take to, communicate to that brain, and how long does the brain give an interval and actual hunger sign again. So there's a gap of almost 6 hours. So even by their sciences, they say that you should only eat at 12 o'clock in the afternoon and then at sundown at 6 p.m. So now if we match this with natural cycles in nature, you see, because modern life is concocted in so many different ways, like people eat because of stress every 2 hours. That's not, you know, that's a dysfunction. It's not natural science. So what, coming back to my story, nobody served breakfast in nature. They have to go out, look for their food, probably takes 2-3 hours. Then they're eating somewhere at 12 o'clock, and that's the time of the digestive fire is the highest. Okay, so it digests very well. So eating lunch at about 6 o'clock. And then obviously once you've eaten something, you're full and you're going to get energy from it in 3-4 hours. Okay, so then you come down to 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock. And then you know that where you're going to sleep and it's going to be some resting time. And then probably, I think all, you know, animals and all that, they've also had some intelligence. Like, you know, if I get up in the middle of the night, I shouldn't feel hunger. So before I retiring, they would go, they would, you know, eat something, find something. And I've seen dogs and all doing this, okay? You give them a certain bread and all, they won't eat it at that time. They take it and they go somewhere, they bury it in the ground. And when they, you know, they're hungry, they eat. So now matching this with reality, I've seen certain seniors, whether it's in Goa and some cities also, women above 55, 60, 65, even men. They said, I don't know how we just graduated to eating twice a day. And we don't have any breakfast. We just have a nice lunch. And then once we retire in the evening, somewhere dinner, you know, at 6 p.m., 7 p.m., that's, we're just living on 2 meals. And they transition to that over a period of, you know, 7, 8, 10 years once they cross 55, 60. So I'm seeing that is working for people who have not got a very physical life. So if you're not a laborer or you're not a, you know, somebody who's running up and down all day, I think even 2 meals a day can do for you. And yeah, if you're doing a lot of work, then probably, you know, breakfast is also required. And I only recommend in the case of, you know, when people, when the gallbladder is removed, okay, then you don't have enough of bile storage for that gallbladder to squeeze and put that bile into the duodenum. So such people cannot have heavy meals because there's not enough bile secreted to mix with the food to, you know, make it neutral and alkaline. So in those cases only, I tell people that you can, you know, you can, instead of 3, like breakfast, lunch and dinner, maybe you can do a maximum of 6 meals a day. So just that smaller portion. Still, that is only for a case of somebody whose gallbladder is removed. I've never seen any person doing well by eating, you know, 6 small meals a day and all of that. I've only seen that, and I'm sure listening to the, you know, Jain Muni's lectures, and I've given a you know, there's a YouTube video of mine about fasting. And in that fasting period, your gut, you know, your gut gets a lot of rest. Because when your gut is doing a lot of work, there are a lot of micro signals that are communicating to your brain. So what I'm trying to say from this is these people who are going to eat 6 meals a day, they are getting constantly bombarded by, you know, look at nature when the lion and tiger, if anybody who eats after they eat, they are resting because that's not the time for the brain to work. Okay. Most of the blood is going into the digestive system. So we should understand that once you eat a meal, it's a time for rest. It's the time for, you know, quiet. So how can a working person eat 6 meals a day and have their brain function optimum when it's trying to digest food? Simple logic.
And I would like to add on to this. Now, I guess Mr. Barney has asked, you know, a general question about this meal pattern. With regard to, yes, of course, you know, certain chronic ailments, you know, 2 meals, even I have started following, even though, you know, I'm into teaching, wherein I do teach clinical nutrition, and I've been talking to my students about, and I'm sure even Mukta, as student of, you know, nutrition, even we were taught the same, okay, of having short and frequent meals. And in practice, it does not really work. But let me tell you, you know, if you have certain patients who have been, you know, who have got frequent tendency of going into hypoglycemia, I think that's the time that we need to, you know, adopt to maybe a more number of meals. So the focus should be on one is meal pattern, and the focus should be also on, you know, the quality of, you know, the nutrients that you are giving. So there are some people who have been, you know, saying eat whatever you want. Okay, now that doesn't mean that, you know, you eat the most ultra processed foods and then do. You know, it has got its own repercussions. Okay, so the quality and the quantity of the food that you're taking is absolutely important. Now, when we talk about, you know, our rapidly growing children, I wouldn't advise them to, you know, stick to two larger meals. Okay, they are the ones who would require definitely, you know, 3 to 4 meals a day with a right balance of macro as well as the micronutrients. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, Varsha. We've got so many questions. I just want the attendees to understand that, you know, our specific questions are better, you know, addressed to the panelists, you know, offline, because there are a lot of very specific questions which have come in. So just moving quickly, is there a center where one can come for rejuvenation and healing? Anyone would like to take this?
Okay, so since I have a center called the Rejuvenation Center, maybe I should speak. So that's it. I was operating that in a small way out of my house. But since the starting of this year, you know, we got a new venue, which has got an organic farm. It's 4.5 acres of property and a huge hall for 1,000 people, and also a place where we could do organic farming. So I started operating out of that place starting of this year. And we were having one health workshop every Sunday. We had made a commitment to 52 health workshops for the entire year. Okay. And we were doing all of these. There were specific programs. One was a bone program. One was the eye problems program. One was for high BP. One was a diabetes program. So we started off that, and we had to kind of, you know, build facilities to stay. And, you know, so we needed funding for that. But unfortunately, you know, the lockdown came in and everything came to a full stop, even our funding. So right now we don't have that. But we are looking to, you know, once things become more, you know, open and this pandemic situation settles down, maybe in 6 months' time, we are looking to start something in that same center. But as of now, I don't have. I'm just saying this because I know many people think that I have a center, and but we are not doing any programs there right now, and we don't have residential capacity. But once the lockdown opens up, we'll be doing a health workshop every Sunday.
Right. Thanks. Thank you, Daryl. The next question is there any way to reverse autoimmune diseases?
I would like to make an opening remark on that, because it's a quote from my book, which says that there is no such thing as an autoimmune disease. Only rightful autoimmune responses from a body that is trying to maintain homeostasis. So by that, what I mean is that this disease word is a real funny thing. We have to understand that the human body knows how to run itself. It's when we do wrong things to the human body, it expresses certain things, which when, you know, mainstream doctors don't understand it, they can call it an autoimmune disease. For example, biggest example is diabetes is still classified as an autoimmune disease. But if people will attend our lecture tomorrow and understand how diabetes is reversed, and it is just a few things, that natural things that you do about, you know, your diet and certain lifestyle changes, then you cease to exhibit that condition. So actually, it's not that the immune system is doing something dysfunctional. It's we are doing something dysfunctional, and when the output comes as an illness, then we call it a disease. So this word autoimmune disease can only be understood when you work on the reality, you take every illness, understand why it happens, and find its proper formula, especially in integrative natural medicine or functional medicine. There are formulas for all of these means, you know, whether it's heart disease or hormonal imbalance or even obesity. So each illness has to be taken and, you know, worked on that way, and then it reverses. So from my area, from what I have seen, all of the mainstream illnesses, I've seen that they are not, you know, autoimmune diseases, meaning that it's not the immune system that is banging you up, you know, or breaking you down. Even arthritis, I don't consider it as an autoimmune disease, because once you change your right, you know, you do the right things, arthritis ceases to express itself. So, and still by that definition, I only agree to you know, those things that are not yet understood till today, you know, what is the working mechanism? You know, I'm okay with somebody calling it an autoimmune disease, but most of the mainstream chronic illnesses, they are understood in integrative natural medicine and functional medicine. There are cures happening and people are using them. It's not something recent. It's been happening since the last, you know, decade. Only people who do the work, they get the results and they see that, oh, that means, you know, I don't have diabetes anymore. And I just did some natural thing. So it was not my immune system that went crazy. It was my wrong choices. Unfortunately, that I thought were the right, because all the mainstream media and television and, you know, we are told a different story. So that is my take on this word, autoimmune diseases. We can only know the truth when we work on each individual, one of them, and break it up and see how to reverse it, and then it stops becoming a disease. If any of the other panelists would also like to speak about their take on autoimmune diseases and how they tackle it. Varsha, would you like to say something about your approach to autoimmune diseases?
Yeah, my take is a little different because see, it's a fact that certain conditions, like, I mean, we've studied, we've learned, and we've seen also that you know, diabetes, arthritis, they are, you know, the autoimmune diseases. Of course, they cannot be cured to, you know, totally, but with, of course, the diet and exercise, the bottom line is diet and exercise, okay, has played a very important role in dealing with them. Reversing, yes, okay, it is possible. It is possible because, as I've said, you know, people who have been on insulin, who have been taking oral hypoglycemic agents, okay, with the proper intervention, we have fantastically managed them, you know, to be off the drugs. So it can, play well. Yeah. Now, with regard to, you know, stress, because many a times, you know, that the stress that has triggered, it has caused, you know, the imbalance of various hormones, you know, the antagonistic hormones especially, and then that is how it has caused, you know, this damage. So I think it's very important for us to, in fact, Dr. Neeru Goyal, when she was talking about, you know, she was sounding so calm, you know, and she said that we have to, breathe in, breathe out, and then so passionately that she spoke about, I think that is what calls for, you know, behavior modification. So if each one, you know, adapt to a good behavior modification, I think we can, deal with many of these autoimmune conditions extremely well. Yeah.
Yes, that's great. Thanks. Thank you, Vasanayak. Now the next question which came in was from Shubham Banwal about how to work on healing the spine, remove clots around the lower back, regulate better blood flow, and activate all the muscles in that area.
Can I answer this?
Sure.
This happens to be in my domain. So I've been dealing with spine as one of my most important area that I deal with. So I would say that in order to ensure a healthy spine, you need to first ensure a healthy gut, a very good digestive system, so that your bone density is good enough. That is the first rule. Then you need to ensure flexibility first in the spine, then strength, then endurance. Endurance will come through walking, or it will come through pranayama practices. Then you need to ensure a proper symmetry of the spine. Symmetry of the spine with respect to the pelvic girdle and the pectoral girdle. It has to be at 90-90 degrees in a neutral position. So as a physiotherapist, I recommend certain postures to rest in, certain sleeping postures. Those are very special postures in which the spine finds its neutral position on its own. It's very easy to do. One has to just learn it, and it is a self-healing technique just to maintain symmetry and alignment. So with time, when you work towards a daily routine, not like a medicine or for a prescription of 7 days or 10 days, when you work in routine on your spine is when the health of the spine improves little by little, day by day. So what has to be done in routine is healthy eating, proper sleeping, routine walking, or else if outdoor activity is coming very hard on you, if the body is already so much crippled, then you think of indoor exercises like pranayama, like meditation, like yoga nidra. Yoga nidra is something very amazing that can help in healing total body, not only spine. And yoga in a very basic way, then slowly progress. It's only when you have a specific problem like a slip disc or spondylitis, or you have any such specific problem, is when a physio can be handy for that temporary phase to see that this specific problem is out of your way and you are able to maintain your routine. Thank you. I hope it helps.
I would also like to add, you know, that I've been very successful with people with spine issues, especially, of course, I agree with everything that Neeru has said. And physiotherapy is an important part. But I also focus on what she said first. You know, first it is, the first level is flexibility. Okay, then comes strength and then endurance. For people who have had slip disc and herniated disc, and I also had, you know, a herniated disc in 2010 when I came over here from lifting a full gas cylinder and trying to keep it in the dickey of my car. So, I used acupressure. So I have some very successful acupressure points that I have given to people, and there's a special way of doing it. It's also explained in this online workshop of mine in the video. And I've seen that, you know, my patients, till the time I didn't know these points, they're not there in most of the, you know, common acupressure books. And I was pretty shocked. They show them somewhere over here, you know, from here to here, but it's not here, it's somewhere actually from here to here. And there's a special way of pressing those points. So I had seen before I found out those points when I was bedridden myself and I was trying the book mentioned points and it wouldn't heal. I had seen patients try those points also, and even to get up from slip disc situation, which is a kind of bedridden situation, it would take people about 1 week's time to get up and, you know, move about. But once I found the right kind of points and gave them to people, within 2 days, they were off their bed and walking around. Okay, so acupressure also plays a very good part in healing the spine. There are points on the hands, there are points on the feet. And so I advise people to do that. And the first few days, I say, don't stress. Don't try, you know, all the deep bends and testing yourself whether your spine is okay. You know, let 1 week go by and then you start a little bit of moving, bending, what your physiotherapist advises you. And I've seen that, yeah, as long as people, and acupressure is a simple thing, as long as the point pains, it shows you actually every day that you're still not healed. That's a good barometer. And when a person gets healed, you know, the pain goes away completely. And that's when I tell them, okay, now you can, you know, go and do all the exercises and go for walk. You know, walking, of course, you can do, but at least jogging and all of that.
All right. One more question was about, should we avoid bread completely? I think we can take that one and close it.
Now, I have a mixed opinion on that.
Okay.
Number one, you know, if we consider diabetes, you know, the glycemic index of bread is very high. So we do not advise, you know, high GI foods, because the spike, you know, of the blood glucose levels, which can happen, is so quick with bread meal, and it has been seen. But nevertheless, you know, whenever we consume bread, if we try to reduce its glycemic index by, you know, having a good amount of high fiber meal along with it, for example, you know, our traditional form of having, let's say, sandwich. Okay, so there's bread and there is you know, the other fibers which are there present from vegetables, then the chutney over there. So you can add, you know, some other seeds, nuts and oil seeds, which are very good sources of, you know, omega-3 fatty acids. So that can be done. Okay, so it's just modifying the form that what you are eating. Secondly, you know, I've come across some very ancient papers wherein bread, which is undergoing fermentation, right? Okay, it's is fermentation. So there we expect, you know, it to have certain important, byproducts generated, which can or which are supposed to be having some good effects. So I would not really advise anyone to completely do away with, but then, you know, not to have that Goan attitude of every morning, you know, that the poder comes and we make our breakfast with bread and tea and coffee. So that I would not really advise on. Okay. So there's no need of, you know, doing away with bread as such. I mean, I practically, I do not, you know, say not to eat this. I would advise you what to eat and how to eat, you know, in a better way. That should be, I think, a nutritionist.
Or Varsha ma'am, maybe instead of that white bread, that maida white bread, better options can be whole wheat bread or multigrain bread. What do you say?
Irrespective of whether it is white or multigrain or, you know, the brown bread. I don't know really how much, you know, wheat, whole complex wheat goes into it. You know, the fiber goes into it, whether it's just the color which is added, that assurance I would not give you. But never have it, you know, in isolation. It's always better to combine it with something and then to make it a more concrete meal. Yeah.
Yeah.
So a more advisable.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, all the attendees, for all your interesting questions. And you all can contact our panelists directly on the numbers provided for any further consultations. Thank you. Thank you all.